So Holger, I'm really glad that you're here. I'm looking very much forward to discovering the man behind the phenomenon, Holger. Willkommen.
Thank you. Just to make this clear, he only said so nice things about me, successful, charming, etc., to get me here and to convince me to play this rabbit out of the hat and being the first one in a complete new series of events, something that that we hadn't had in that form before in Berlin. And therefore, let's see, it is the first event, right? It's also not only for the organizers, also for me here, for the format, the first event. And we spent now the next, I don't know, 45 minutes, 60 minutes together to hear a little bit, not about the phenomenon, but a little bit of the background of being an entrepreneur. Having said that, I first would like to say, because you mentioned that, right? I mean, it's quite impressive to stand here and see all this, because if you're a little bit in history, and we just looked out of the windows looking on the rebuilt castle outside there, it's quite phenomenal if you think what happened with this city over the past 25 years, right? And if you're looking from outside to Berlin and you're reading all these startup stories and also blogs and New York Times writes about the latest startup spots and the hippest bars and so on, it's sometimes good also to have someone like Christoph around who gives a stage to the older guys who are not jumping on every stage anymore and who are meanwhile a little bit in a stage where I do not actually understand all new startup ideas, but that's also something that maybe comes with the fact that you're focusing on different things. So that's one thing. The other thing is when Christoph actually called me and he was in Sri Lanka at the beach and I saw the message on Facebook and I say, hey, we created this new thing, the GTEC, right? And I had no clue what it is, and then next day there was the press release and I was impressed by a press release because it is really something impressive. I was not too impressed by Christoph starting the next thing, because that's something that happening any other year, right? Berlin Startup Academy, the band camp, no, the band battle, and now the GTEC, GTEC. No, it was more about the background of that, and that is something. If you're talking to him, and I'm missing Benny. Benny's not here. No, good. That's something really phenomenal. I mean, we're sitting now here and it's the first evening of a new event and let's see how this goes, open lectures. I mean, let's see what I can lecture you about. But it's more the conceptual idea that you're sitting here, especially on this historic place, right, where for about 40 years entrepreneurship was literally not existing, right? And that this country also has a great tradition in general in entrepreneurship, but it's not something that is too much in the genes. And it's not as you can see this in the Valley, etc., all this founding mood. I mean, every one of us who went to the Valley from time to time comes back extremely inspired, etc. And thinking about that, it's something that actually can make an economy stable and which can bring, I don't speak about wealth, but it can bring education to people. People can create out of that. Companies can give work to other people, etc. So, and Christoph and Benny actually started to build something that will teach entrepreneurship in one or the other way, right? But we talked about this 2 weeks ago with a gin tonic, luckily. And you said one day maybe we want to be in schools and having this in schools and so on. So I think it's a phenomenal thing. And now let's see what I can add to that. So, who of you is an entrepreneur or is running a company or started a company or whatever? Okay, yeah, that's about 50%. Who wants to become one? Okay. And who's happy in general? Entrepreneurs, not entrepreneurs, with what they're doing? Guys, okay, that's a kind of responsibility for tonight. So I was thinking rather a long time about what, I mean, the first lecture of, or the first session of open lectures about entrepreneurship, what should that be, right? And then I thought, okay, I could tell you a little bit about company building, I could tell you a little bit about financing, I could tell you what it means to become a CEO or being a CEO, etc., and so on. And I said, that's all too concrete. I will tell you a little bit about today how different it looks from inside being an entrepreneur or becoming it then from outside, and that many moments in the past 20 years or let's say 15 years, I really had wished not to become what I am. Today I'm very happy about, but the way to that is, it's not a straight way, right? I mean, actually, this is where you can see a little bit how old I am, right? This is 20 years. Wow, that's long. Terrible. No, but I mean, I'm not an entrepreneur by birth, right? I mean, who is? Maybe if parents have a company and you know that you're working in that company, one day you will take it over. You're sitting at the lunch and talking with dad about entrepreneurial issues and how to fire people, how to hire people, all that. I hadn't had that, right? I come from a very normal, in a very positive sense, very normal home and a house, but definitely not entrepreneurs, right? My parents are both, used to be both employees, and I was definitely thinking about, and I played a little bit around with that, and when I was, I don't know, 16, 17, the younger of you cannot remember, there was something that we called answering machines for phones, right? I mean, phones had cables, right? There was a machine next to that that recorded the call, you call it voicemail. And I started to trade them, right? I bought them from a wholesaler, etc. But that was a little bit, I had my pocket money and I worked for that and so on. And then I realized, I had to buy 20 to get a better price. And I could not go to the party in the evening because I had to wait for someone calling me because he wanted to order two, etc. So I stepped into that, but it was not that I thought that's really my thing. Another point was that I really thought, I have to go for a traditional career, right? Whatever it takes. I didn't want to become a doctor or a lawyer, etc. I wanted to become a manager. So, and my mom at that time, when I was, 15, 16, she asked me, what do you want to become? I said, manager. And she said, so you have to study economics. So I said, okay, then I have to study economics. And you see here, it was all planned to become a very classic career. So I did my studies. I started to a traineeship with Axel Springer, at that time still in Hamburg, so did my traineeship. Then I changed to ProSiebenSat.1, one of the bigger media groups here in Germany. Worked in marketing and so on. So. But then there came two things together, right? One thing was that in that time role, I was not too happy, what sometimes helps to move you, right? That's I only can recommend, if you feel in a situation not too comfortable, change it immediately. It only can bring good things. The other thing is that the first internet bubble just burst, right? So all this first hype, and there was a company in Germany called ESMT. I don't know who can remember one of these phenomena. They rose, their stock price in Deutschmark at that time rose from, 150 after IPO to over 1,600 in 7 weeks or something like that, right? And that just collapsed, but it happened to me because I'm so old. It happened to me that some of my classmates in university joined that first wave while I was following my classic career. By the way, at that time, before I forget that, that's 20 years ago, right? Today, that's what I'm saying, we are the older generation now. Today, people finish school, right? And then they come to Berlin from out of the world and want to create a startup, right? That's what they do. Or they join, one of the first class universities, and then they graduate and they don't go and join McKinsey, Boston Consulting, etc. They come and want to create a startup. That was definitely different 20 years ago, right? If you would go to your parents and say, I first do university and then I start a startup, that was a term unknown. And at that time, with respect to a classic career, right, you went first to a bank if you did economics, right? Apprenticeship, Banklehre at that time. And then you started studies, because if you failed in studies, then you still could go back. Okay. Going back to that moment, so I was not very happy in my role. And then I had some classmates who actually were already in the first wave, and some of them were successful, not all of them. But I was in a situation that in my end 20s, 28, 29, I had two or three guys around me who built a company, who sold the company, and started to invest in new companies, and so on. And so, long story short, I thought at that very moment, okay, before this internet thing is over again, right, I better should experience it. So I left it, and then you see, then my classic career was over, right, definitely. And so I then joined a young team, a startup that just was created, Gate 5, and that was actually really the initial step into understanding what it means to be an entrepreneur, right? And that also brings me to the point, what is an entrepreneur? Are you only entrepreneur if you're a founder? Are you only entrepreneur if you invested your own money, etc.? I don't think so, right? I mean, that's definitely somehow explanation for that. But if you're joining an unstable construct in a market that is literally not existing, right, where you coping with the situation that there is no money anymore and that there is no money, there is no salary anymore, etc. All that trains entrepreneurship skills in you, right? And you will see very early, can you stand it or not? So, and that is something I'm only telling this so long because this is 2000, right? And we have 15 years later now, right? And in between, right, many things happen, but not too many exciting things. Everything is exciting, but it was a long time, 7 years, and we will talk about that before we came finally to the point that we managed to sell the company. And that's what I meant in the beginning, right? Today, I love to tell the story. We sold the company to Nokia, believe me. I mean, everyone would do that, right? But it was not easy. And it's something that for, I would say, 95% of the time, it was very more likely that all the thing goes belly up than a success. Right? And that is something where you're depending on that very much, and you cannot tell the story, so you still have to motivate you. And so we sold it, right? Then I invested a little bit in 2008 in a young team here in Berlin that just created Aupeo. Then I joined Aupeo and as CEO, and then all the startup story started again with all ups and downs, right? And then we managed last year, actually almost 2 years ago, to sell it to Panasonic. So, and that is something, just to make this clear, you're looking from outside, and that's what I said before to Christoph when we talked. It's, of course, a little bit this celebrity VIP. You're looking on success stories. You know, you see the guys from Instagram. You see the guys from Daily Deal. You see whatever. I mean, there are these success stories that we all think are very exciting. But first of all, to get there is a long way. But the other part is that unfortunately there are maybe, I don't know, 10 who make it or 100 who make it, and there are a lot of stories in between who don't make it, right? And there's a lot of experience in between that you better would have skipped, right? I mean, we know each other since 2003, right? Right? That's amazing. We started to work at that time with his first startup, Empresso, neighbors with Gate 5, and we had no product with Gate 5, but these guys came and had their own ideas, so we started to cooperate, etc. 2003, that's 12 years ago. Right? So, and I said this before, if I only had knew earlier, and one thing, what you sometimes see this when I give speech, the next picture, I love to use it, because if I only had knew earlier that this exists, I maybe had been more careful to start all this. You know what this is? That's the Gartner hype cycle for emerging technologies. They do this, I think, since 1995, right? And it's very easy to explain. There are different phases, so you have expectations on the one axis, on time on the other, right? And there is innovation, then you have the hype, then you have disillusionment, you have the slope of enlightenment, the plateau of productivity, right? If you see this here, and you see the different names there, the bubbles and the triangles, etc., that are all technologies, one or the other way, right? And it shows you, right, very interesting, how long it might take if you're in a hype before this product can be a success, right? For example, if you see here, quantum computing, right? It says more than 10 years. Right? Somehow it's a hype in certain cycles and in certain groups. It's about quantum, and if you now say, okay, I create a company on that, or I join a company on that, etc., only because it's a hype or people talking about it doesn't mean that the world is ready for it. Right? And that is also, if you see here, Internet of Things right at the top of the hype. Right? I mean, 5 years ago, no one talked about Internet of Things. Now everyone talks about Internet of Things. Right? Internet of Things, IP-beacon platforms, that at the top of the hype. From a startup perspective and from a founder perspective, what do you have to do on the top of the hype? Sell it. You have to sell it or you have to collect money, because afterwards it's very difficult, right, to get any attraction back to your company, because either, I mean, maybe you get belly up and then it only was a hype, but if it's substantial technology, right, then it can take a while. And we will see this in a second, why I say I would have wish to have it, but sometimes it's also better if not, because you never would start there. So, just a little bit to compare this. This is the hype cycle 2000, right? A little bit more simple, right? Bluetooth hype was over in 2000, right? We had biometrics, ASPs. No one is talking about ASPs anymore. We call this SaaS today, right? The ASPs were XML. XML still here, different, less than 2 years. And that's pretty precise. The funny thing is, quantum computing was already there. 10 years later, or what was the last one, was from 2014 years later, it's still over 10 years. So you also can be very, very bad. So, and this one is about, I didn't find a better one, but about 2002, right? So we started the company, or the company was started in 99, I joined in 2000. So, and Gate 5 was all about location, so we did maps on big server environments, some microsystem, parallel computing machines, blah, 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 all HTML based, right? And then we get good funding in 99, that was before the bubble burst, so we had a little bit money. Then we built a big company, big people, met many people, and so on. And then happened something that was September 11, which actually is something you cannot predict, right? But another thing is, and that's why I put this, location was in 2002 absolutely not interesting anymore. I mean, no one actually thought about that, because it was a big hype in 2000, and we built this and so on, but there were no, of course, there were no smartphones, right? But their location, how you detect the location, GPS on phones came in 2006 or 7, right? Mapping, nice to have it on the web. We figured out that people don't use web maps and sending messages through SMS gateway, that's much too nerdy, right? Everything what we had was somehow nice, but it was far away. So with the effect that what I'm saying, right, we were here and there are 6 more years to go, right? With the effect that no one was interested in us. So. And that means, coming back, if I only had knew earlier, then comes the hard time of being an entrepreneur, right? Which starts, no, it doesn't start, but that's a very traditional routine then. If you're still around and you're still with the company and you're coming home on Christmas, right? That's a very interesting moment then. When your parents asking you, say, are you still with this company? We do not know what the company is doing. And you say yes, and then comes the story that your cousin got another promotion, and that he has now 2 company cars and 3 personal assistants and flying business class, etc. And you are still with it. That's something. It's just a little social pressure, but you know what parents can put pressure on you if they think this early part of your career that was somehow a little bit more out of it. First of all, we could tell what you do. Secondly, the name of your employer was known, so that was easier to tell friends and families, right? And that's one thing. But the other thing is yourself, right? Most of you, I mean, not everyone, but most of you starting a company are in their most creative lifetime, right? I mean, you are creative when you're young and old, so that's not the point, but it's in a classic sense, the mid-20s to the mid-30s, that's something when you build the roots for maybe a career or business, etc. So, and then you're working for something 5, 6, 7 years, right? And I cannot count the moments, and I'm pretty sure that everyone of us at that time in the leadership team did this, cannot count the moments how often I thought, I'm an idiot, what I'm doing here, right? I mean, you literally earn a fraction of people who have a real job, right? There are parts, or there are times where you don't get any salaries, right? Not because someone forcing you, because you agreed with that, you say we have people with families, so maybe they should. But this is all something that you have to stand. Right? And that's, again, that's something that telling retroactively, and then we sold the company to Nokia, or Panasonic, is nice, and it's told in 15 seconds, right? But those are the moments, those are really the dark moments, believe me, right? And I remember that at that time we had the office at the Schönhauser Allee, and the Prenzlauer Berg did not look as it looked today, so there was no Soho House, there were Soho Club, there was nothing. Actually, all the houses got renovated, so whatsoever. But there was a gym, a fitness, and I went in the morning always to that, Schönhauser Allee Garden, and did my run there in the morning, and I looked out of the window, and I was thinking, I'm an idiot. I stop that. And I go now and I'm looking for a job, right? I honestly, there was a time where I looked around and I think that's natural because you think I'm now 33. I'm for almost 4 years, 5 years with the company. We have no product, we have no revenues. We have great vision, we have fantastic guys, but that's not really what that's not really what I wanted. What, in that time, and I'm thinking a lot about that, what in that time really helped to stay in that experience was that we were a very close group of friends, or we became friends out of building this company together, and all of them definitely had other possibilities, right? I mean, you know the bunch of people we work with, I mean, really, really good people, and none of them left. I mean, people left, we hired new one and so on, but the core, right? And that is something what I also learned, it's never your own success, right? It's something, of course it's not your own success, it's a team success, and there are so many elements counting into that, that at the end it happens. So that's this time factor, right? You have to have the right timing, and you can't be too late, right? But you can also be way too early. In Gate 5, at that time, our developers, I mean, we had literally all the map of Germany, and we had all buildings of Berlin in 3D in the map, right? And the developers were thinking about if they could rendering the shape of the building according to the sun, how the sun angle was per day, right? Because they wanted to know in which street cafe they could sit in the afternoon and having their coffee and still see some. That's something that was a little bit early. Today it sounds trivial because you have all this on your smartphone. And a couple of weeks ago there was a posting on Facebook that was actually a promotion flyer from Target or Best Buy or whatsoever, right? I think from the late 90s, maybe mid 90s, 97, 98. 10 different applications and machines, right? And the headline was, none of those exist anymore, it's all on your smartphone, fax machine and all of that, right? So it's something where you definitely need the right timing, but the other thing is of course, that you also need the team and the discipline, right? It's something what I definitely learned, and that's something no matter with whom you're talking or which success you can see, that doesn't just work by
accident, right? People working hard and a lot. So that's definitely a point. So coming after that, I thought I have one more. No, what I actually wanted to tell you, and that's something that that's why I'm saying there's the time and there's the team, but it's also looking for success from outside, right? It is also luck, simply as it is. I mean, it, not only, never happens that it's simply luck that you go and creating something, it has to do with the team, etc. But it's there is this element that you cannot influence, right? And that's, call it luck, or the right moment, or a little bit fate, or I don't know. And that you meet in the right moment the right person that is interested in what you're doing, right? That you hadn't meet the next day, and you come into that talk, and then you start to work with this company, and so on and so forth, right? Or it's luck also with respect or bad luck, right? I mean, at the beginning, we had this bad luck with 9/11. That was not planned. After 9/11, no one actually welcomed us as a entrepreneur or as a startup. And in 2005, some investors invited us, asking us, telling us that they are not interested to invest into us. They just wanted to see how the guys are doing that are still around, right? Because I mean, it took so long to collect the money and to get all the meetings, right? So, but that's one point. The other point is really that. Sometimes retroactively, it all looks so easy again, and the story tells nicely. But you also have to see that there are elements where you cannot simply say that that is something I planned, right? And that, I mean, one example I have in that respect with Gate 5. At that time, we had the situation that. We believed that navigation will become mobile, so we created this navigation system for Nokia phones, right? Which was fantastic, and we were the first one in 2005, etc. So, but at that time there were no phones in the market, and it was not really, GPS was not in the phones, so it was complex, but we believed very much into that this now should be the breakthrough. And I was on a trade show, on a fair, Mobile World Congress in Cannes at that time. And one afternoon, I was standing there at the booth, and there came a guy, an Asian guy, and asked me what I'm having there. And I told him I'm having this this technology and here on a Nokia phone. And he said he's not interested in Nokia phones, but he's interested in that software. If I could come and see him in Taiwan, I said, no. What should I do in Taiwan, right? And I know a bit to Asia, and whatsoever. We exchanged business cards, and then after the show, I did not remember him, but this is what you do, right? That you then check the business cards, write nice emails, we had a great conversation, blah, 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 right? And did not really know what this guy was about. And then he came back immediately and said, oh, that was a really nice conversation. When do you come to Taiwan? I said, okay. Why? He said, there is a great business here and it's something that I would like to introduce to you. So long story short, I bought a ticket, or we bought a ticket, and we went to Taiwan, right? And met this guy in a hotel in the center of Taipei. I've never been to Asia, right? Later I moved to Hong Kong for 2 years, so now you can sense what this moment meant to me. And we talked to him, and I had no clue what he's doing. He just said, I have big business for you. So, a little bit technical explanation. At that time, if you see how Asia is working, right? If there's a new tech trend, usually tech trends are developed in the US, right? Or Germany, or in Europe, etc. But all the hardware is manufactured in Asia. So, meaning MP3 players or Blu-ray players and so on. So, if there is a new trend, right? Then all Asia is changing the machinery and is producing on that trend. What happened at that time, or what had happened at that time, that there were these personal navigation systems that you had in the windshield, right, the TomTom Go, right, turned very successful. So all Asia started to develop these devices that you could buy for a time in a discounter, bakery, everywhere. I mean, you could buy this everywhere. So Asia tradition is very good in hardware, but they are not too good in software, or they don't have software. So meaning that they could produce the hardware, but they needed a software, which made sense. Navigation software to sell this because they needed it. And this guy we had met, or I had met, coincidentally on that show, he actually was the exclusive importer for Taiwan for the leading chipset for GPS. So he had 99% market share in Taiwan, and Taiwan at that time had about 89% market share GPS sets of the world market. And I said, okay, I mean, then I only have to talk to you now. And he said, yes. So that's something, long story, but that's something, I mean, if I hadn't had bumped into that guy or he into me, right, beside that, that of course all others also worked on that, but that was a breakthrough because after, I don't know, 5-6 years without really any product and any success, we hadn't had that chance, right? Or with Aupeo now. I mean, now Aupeo is part of the Panasonic Group, and that's a huge Japanese conglomerate, as you know. And we worked, first we did music streaming. Just music streaming, an app, we did a channel for you, a rock app, right? That was metal, sorry, classic metal. But we were quick, right? 24 hours, something like that. Ooh. And we believed into that, and we had a great user interface, and we had great apps, and we pumped money in marketing, but we could not get this service really running big, because, I mean, believe me, if any one of you, right, wakes up tomorrow or any other day of the next year thinking about, I should do a music startup, call me, really, you don't want to do that. So, long story short, Then we started to work around in different industries. So we had the Aupeo streaming service bundled on connected TVs and on laptops and so on and so. At that time, back in 2009-10, we started to work also with some car companies because they started to implement apps into the cars because that was easier to sell cars. If you want to be modern, then you have apps in cars, so more marketing. And we had this music service, and the music service was naturally suited for the car, fitted in the car, because radio in the car is for 80 years, so that was perfect. So, long story short, we did this and we figured out, that seems to be interesting, and that's something. So, and then I started to call an old friend who I knew from somewhat this time, right? And I knew that this guy is working in automotive in Panasonic. Right? So I called him and he came along on a business trip and I told him what we're doing, etc. So, and it took us, I don't know, maybe 2 years, right? But that was that I remembered this guy, right? Then I called him and out of that, somehow we started to do business and then there was a strategic cooperation and so on and so forth. And the rest is history, right? So, you can do a lot, and it's not always fun, believe me, but at the end, and that's the quintessence, one sentence, then I'm done, the quintessence, you cannot do what we want to do, what you all want to do, without that little luck that it sometimes needs, and that's something that I think we all deserve. So.
Is this
at
the end?
That's the end.
Then it's first round of applause.
Oh!
And we will do some questions.
There was already a question.
Before that, I want you to do one thing. Show us where you are now on the hype cycle.
Me personally?
Yeah, where are you?
Holger?
Trough of the disillusionment?
I'm on the plateau of productivity. I've entered the second half of my productivity life. No, it's all good. Everywhere. I mean, definitely. With some things in my life, maybe there's a little disillusion with my investments and stocks. A couple of years ago, I was very much here, right? Hype, yeah, sure. I'm always on that privately. No details here.
Got it.
In general, I think I'm good.
And one more thing that we want to find out in our talks here is, how did this change you? How are you a different man now that you were 15 years ago? How did this hype cycle and everything you went through influence you to be a different human being?
Can I answer this in a second? Because there was a question, and actually, we have to be fair here. He was first.
But this is like, you know, to further the education for this.
We do it in a second, but I think that was a question directly, because...
Yeah, exactly. Thank you, Holger. And if I understand you right, the vision, beginning of these two companies were big global B2C players, to be big, and then you switched to B2B market and had success with customers in the B2B segment. That's interesting because it happened to us as well. So we were not funded too much, and so we needed to go to a market that it's there, and it was the B2B market. So, but this makes an entrepreneur to find new ways of what has existed and teams and technology, and then at the end it can be a success. So that was the question. The vision was big, huge B2C, and then turned into B2B, but successful.
No, absolutely, and I can't even answer your question by referring to that. So, of course, I mean that's a path you learn, and I mean if we would have more time or whatever, another evening we can talk about flexibility, right? That's something that you learn the hard way. At the end, it is something that you also have to experience with yourself and with your company, right? One thing that I learned over the years becoming an entrepreneur, as said, I'm not an entrepreneur by nature or born or whatsoever, is that you have a DNA, right? But also a company has a DNA. And understanding that if you want to turn a company into, let's say, a kind of a hype consumer jumping on the stage, right, and everyone is singing, B2C company, while the gene and the DNA is more technology and not too much extroverted, that's something that you first have to learn, right? And that is what changed me, of course, right? When I started, so professionally, I think it's simply every day is a new experience, right? And there are things that I still don't like in being an entrepreneur is one thing, right? But that sounds so generic. Simply being a managing director, right? That when I was not, I wanted to be one because I thought it's nice on the business card. It's bullshit. I mean, it's something you have all these auditings and accounting and financing, etc. I know people who love it, right? So hire those people and make them responsible for that. But at the end, you have to do this, and it's a major part of my time, right? And that's something that you have to go through. It's a little bit the discipline that you also have to show, I think, in that general way. Personally, I think that in certain parts I became harder. That's at least what I hear from friends, that they say, okay, apparently you have to do some, I don't know, decision process, et cetera, where sometimes are too fast on a personal level to say, no, we do this and this way, what usually I think is not my attitude. But in general, I hope at least it hasn't changed me too much, right? I mean, one thing is clear that going this way and still being in an extreme happy relationship, that's something that stabilizes you a lot. And that gives us stuff for another evening, right? What does it mean to be backed, or what do you need to go all through this, right? And that you have someone at your side who's sharing this with you and not saying, okay, oh, there's no salary coming? That's not so good. I mean, and that's the minimum. Good.
Well, thank you very much. This was it was great to hear this because there were so many things that have parallels with experience that I've had. I've been around the track even longer.
I'm sure.
But the same deal, the same thing, starting out in the big company and then moving and how you get into this. But one thing that struck me, you described it as luck, but it seemed to me that a lot of it had to do with specific people. There's, you run into somebody. I'm looking back at my experience. There's always some guy that I ran into. Maybe it was a professor that I had at business school who got lucky and got married and became an investor and then hired me for a startup that he was working on. Or then somebody else that you run into. Or you meet a technical guy at a conference and he brings you into a new idea. It seems that the people that you, sometimes by chance, but not everything is chance. One thing leads to another. You put yourself into certain positions that lead to those opportunities. I guess some of them are good, and then a lot of them don't work out.
Yeah.
You know, and so that sometimes a lot of the art is knowing when something is really right, when something feels right, when that person is onto a good idea, or no, it's not. That's bullshit. That's not going to work, and I'm going to regret it in 3 to 5 years if I go with that. But it's hard, you know, you have experience, but it's hard to generalize. And sometimes you run into somebody and think, oh, this is going to be great. And then it isn't. Then sometimes it is. But do you have any way to say how do you establish some judgment meter about when somebody's onto something or when, you know, thing or back?
I mean, there's no standard methodology to do that, right? First of all, I think you're perfectly right. It depends a little bit from which angle you see it. Right? Luck also could be destiny or fate or something like that, right? Was this guy I ran into from Taiwan, did he come along because that was an accident? Or I don't know. I mean, that's it, right? It happens over and over that you run into those situations where you say, okay, and that was completely stupid, right? There's gut feeling, right? And that's also experience, but that has nothing to do with doing what I did, or you all have this, that you think you have a growing sense for people, right? And you can read them, and from time to time there's a big disappointment because it's, how could I be so stupid, or I never had expected that would happen to me, and things like that. One thing is something that you learn over time, but it's not. There's no warranty for that. That you see that certain constellations do not work, right? When someone is coming and says, "You are a small company, we are a small company. You have no money, we have no money. But definitely together, this could be something really big." No, it's a waste of time. Right? It's definitely a waste of time. Something like that, right? Or that coming back to the B2B experience, we had this discussion, cold call, right? Chris was also running the Berlin Startup Academy, and sometimes I give lectures for sales, etc. So no matter, but in B2B it's clear, right? You have to call into big corporates, etc. And then you run on trade shows, and you are there with your business cards and your LinkedIns, and you want to talk to someone in Microsoft and so on. You will not meet someone at a booth, unless it's fate or destiny, who gives you your business card and you call him the next day and somehow you start. That's something, I mean, you can spend 3 years with the wrong people, right? They are nice, but they also want to be entertained and they invite you and you fly to London, Seattle, I don't know, to do all these great meetings, and then you learn after time that he's not a decision maker, and the next time he's gone, right? And you say, okay, things like that. But other than that, I have to judge every time from you. So, Philip. Philip just moved to Berlin from New Zealand.
Yeah, hello,
thank you. Become entrepreneur.
You mentioned the music industry. Why is it so hard, in your experience, to create startups with the music industry?
Well, now I have to be careful because you filmed this here, right? And I don't want to be sued by the music industry. Let me be careful to express it politely. There was a startup 3 years ago called Turntable FM. Right, and overnight, I mean, literally within 3 weeks or 4 weeks, they turned from zero to to 500,000 concurrent users on the platform, doing DJing and winning gamification points and so on. So every VC on the world who had a little bit to do with that matter was in that application, and they grew from zero to, I think, a valuation of 40 million within 6 weeks, right? And so people threw money into that. They closed last year. And one of the founder, he wrote a long blog where he said, it's literally at the moment not possible because of the size of the music licenses to do any profitable music service, right? Because to do a legal music service at the moment, under almost all conditions, is maybe 3-4 times more expensive than people would be willing to pay for. And that has to do with this dynamic of this industry. It has to do with the past of the industry. If you license today digital music as a platform, right? Believe it or not, you have to pay a packaging license, but you download the music. And say, okay, why do I have to pay for packaging? Because that was always the case. Because when there were covers, record covers or CD covers, there are pictures on, etc., and there was a whatever 20% or I don't know of a certain license that went to the music industry and to the artists and so on. So now there is no package anymore, but you still have to pay the license. Just one stupid example, but that's the case. Look, people like Spotify with something like I think 50 million paying subscribers, something like that, not profitable. This is one case where the digitalization of content and business models simply is clashing, right? There are some people, unknown bands, who say that's phenomenal that I'm on a streaming portal because I got discovered by this and I got invited to that club and then to another club. Now we have an album and we have, so it made us famous. And there are a lot who say they don't pay me, right? And there are some, you know, Linkin Park, right, and they do, I think, 75% of their revenues with merchandising, right, which the average band is not able to do. It's, I mean, Kathy, you know, it's a very difficult industry, and it's so complex in its construct, right, that I don't think there's anyone who really understands it completely. Not the record labels, not the publishers, not the lawyers, not the people running the startups based on that, right? Because it's simply, I mean, if you want to have a streaming service in Germany, only in Germany, right? You have to talk, if you want to have all songs, maybe you have to negotiate 25 different music licenses with 25 different labels, the big ones, Universal, Sony and so on, but also the smaller ones, the independent ones. And then you have to negotiate a web license and a mobile license, and you have to negotiate an offline license that you can download the songs and still listen to that, right? So you have 25 times 3 licenses that you have to negotiate, and then you have to put a lot of money on the table to get that license. As a, if you wake up tomorrow saying, Alex, if you want to do a music startup, call me before.
Holger, I'm guessing that you some day in the future will start up a new company. In which segment would you go? Is it, would you start, would you try to go to B2C again, or would you immediately start with B2B, or, and in the majority phase, which phase would you choose to build your next company?
I don't know. At least at the moment I have no plans. So, what the future will bring, let's see. One thing is clear, and that's what I said. I mean, if I would start again a B2C company, I hadn't learned anything in the past. Because, I mean, if I would start a new company, at least I would like to benefit from my experience. And I think I'm simply a B2B guy, right? I definitely would like to do something less complex, right? Somehow I have this tendency always to join this very interesting, right? Super interesting, exciting, but very complex things. I mean, navigation with all the digital licenses now, streaming, you have so many stakeholders in it. So probably B2B B2B, not B2C. One thing I learned, also a little bit from an investor perspective, it's also better that you invest into things that you understand, right? I once, very early, I little angel investments, I'm not a big investor, but I invested into, at that time, as I thought, phenomenal dating startup, right? That was back in 2008, mobile dating. And believe me or not, it was Tinder 2008. We had everything set, right? But dating is a difficult thing to understand if you're in a lucky relationship and you don't use dating. At that time, I mean, I had to tell my wife, oh, I'm just trying the app. But even that was something I was not interested in. No, of course, I tried the app in its functionality. But I did not understand that, right? So don't invest. Though. At least if you do it as I do, that I also want to help to build companies and more consult than put money. I mean, with my little money, I cannot really build big companies. Right? I'll let you know if I have the next thing.
I actually have two questions. One is, did you join Gate 5 and, or it seemed a bit like you joined Gate 5 and Aupeo when they already had been started? Mm-hmm. So did you both join them as a CEO?
No. Gate 5 I joined at that time as a business development manager, right? So, there was the founder team and we created a little bit business sense around the founder team. Gate 5 actually was created out of the Chaos Computer Club, if we are really clear about that, right? So there was a lot of technology, but not too much at that time business sense. So we joined at that time also our CEO, or he was chairman of the board, joined and we created that. That was maybe half a year after the company was created. And with Aupeo, I was initially an angel investor and then joined later as CEO, right?
Okay, and what are the biggest challenges for when you joined Aupeo, like at the beginning for a startup, what do you think are like the two, three biggest challenges when growing a startup?
I think what always is a challenge at the beginning is to find the right product and the right approach, because you have ideas, right, and you have a concept to start with. I mean, of course, if you say, okay, it's only for me, that just another e-commerce startup, and now it's about underwear and shoes and tableware, I don't know, black bananas, I mean, everything you can do, and then it's about SEO, you know the rules, right? But not if you're in a very early stage, where you say, okay, this is maybe a market that is just created, right? So it's really to find the spot where you say, okay, this is the direction. Because, I mean, you saw this, it's not only my life in general that goes like that or went like that. It's also how you do that. B2C, B2B, online, offline, mobile, those are the questions. I think that's the first thing. Second thing is team, right? I mean, what I really learned in both companies, that team is overly important. You cannot do anything without a team. And someone asked me earlier, that was Christoph, right? What was one of the hardest, or what when I had a hard time as entrepreneur? If someone is leaving your company that you have highest respect for whatever reason, right? That's that hard time, right? That's a hard time if someone is quitting because maybe it's not comfortable, got a better proposal, whatsoever, right? And team is second, and then third, of course, is I think at the beginning, is coming to a point where you do quick decisions. That's about flexibility. What I learned, don't try too long. You build something. I mean, that's the most frustrating thing as an entrepreneur, right? You come with this idea. Maybe not you, someone in your team came with this idea and said, I believe in that idea, we do this now, right? So we contribute resources. You're always short of resources, right? I mean, developers are always, I mean, whatsoever. But you say, we do this and we want to do this. And then you work day and night and you build a marketing campaign and you see, and then it's, I don't know, Friday night, 5 o'clock, and you did everything right, you think, you did focus groups, 6 weeks, and so on, day and night, every weekend, and you push the button and say, now it's live. And you start the Twitter campaign, and you start the Facebook campaign, in B2C, right? And nothing is happening, right? And you look then and say, okay, it's Friday night, but of course, so we look in it on Sunday afternoon when guys are at home. It's a little bit Monday, once, so. And this continues over 2, 3, 4 weeks, right? Of course, you're changing and you're adopting and so on, but that's something, for example, with many other examples where I learned that you rather do quick decisions and say, okay, we stop it, right? Or we do a fundamental shift and so on.
Would you be able to recommend a book or any other resource that you read over the years and that helped you a little bit?
No. There are a lot of good books and panning really much in what you're focusing on, right? I once wanted to write a book for startups. That was years ago when I met this guy from Taiwan. It really happened that from that day onwards, I was traveling every 2 weeks to Asia. And then I spent 2 weeks in Asia and came back for 1 week. So whatsoever. Sounds phenomenal, but it's exhausting, of course, right? Because you're constantly on the road. And you get experience with business class and cheap hotels in China, in Asia, right? And that's something where I wanted to write a guide for cheap traveling to China. If I had wrote that book, I had recommended it. No, it's also a little bit that I think you can learn a lot from, but at the end you have to experience it. So there's sometimes maybe the Bible. Sorry.
Thank you. Holger, you talk about the slope of enlightenment, and we were just discussing this process of, you know, how to be successful, isn't it? And you were also talking about team a lot. I'm actually wondering, I mean, there's, you know, sufficient knowledge probably, and, you know, has been in both of your teams. However, you know, How did you narrow down your path on being, you know, successful? What was the communication in the team? How did you work with each other? You know, apart from obviously the obvious things in terms of, you know, the work, the development work that has to be done once you follow a path.
Good question. And I don't want to talk too much about the two companies and the two teams, so I generalize this a little bit more. But one thing, what I learned, and I said this before, that we became friends over time because we also went to hard times, but we fought so hard with each other that sometimes people left the room, conference room, right? And that was something where it was about the thing, but it has nothing to do with the friendship or the personal relationship. That's something that where you have to be extremely stable together, same in a relationship, right? Where you say, okay, I can tell you and I have to tell you, this idea will not fly. I will not support that. You don't get the money. Oh, I don't know, something like that. Because you're believing in your opinion, right? Maybe not always the right one, but that's, for example, one point I think that is extremely important, that you then open the door of the conference room or the meeting room and say, okay, that's done, let's go for a drink or let's go for lunch. That's one thing that I saw working with teams. The other one is trust, right? I'm not a micromanager. I think sometimes I'm managing not enough micro, but also things to do. But I think when I'm hiring people or we're working as a team and someone has a dedicated responsibility, I'm responsible for making him or her able to do and to play her role, right? And if I can see something is wrong and there's too much pressure or I don't know, I have to interfere and have to help, I have to coach, right? But at the end, I mean, I don't need people for other things if I have to do it at the end on my own. And that has to do a little bit with trust. You say, okay, if it doesn't work, then we maybe have to work different ways again, but so far, you have the title, go for it. Right. But I also think there, I mean, coming back to the books, there are a lot of books about team building and communication and so on, but I would not have a general concept for that, right? As that, one thing that I experienced in both, oh, two more things, thinking about that. One thing, what is extremely important in a team is accepting roles, right? You say, okay, you are the head of product, not me, even if I'm CEO. You are the head of product, so you run this. And in the other way around, also I have to accept that there is a leadership role. I have another presentation, being a CEO, where there's one slide, running a company is not a democracy. Right? There's a reason for hierarchy. And that means that if you, I know there are companies doing this, and fine, that's maybe a different style of leadership, but I think that's also something I say, okay, that's something I'm here because I'm trusting you, and when I'm not trusting you on the other side, other direction, right, then I have to walk alone, and that's also part of that. There was another question.
Holger, my question is, so as a successful CEO within the startup scene, you do these things a lot where you actually share your knowledge, then you've told us some things that in your position you don't really enjoy, such as the admin side. So my question is, in the position as a CEO and what comes around that success, what really gets your blood pumping? What is it that you love about it?
It's still company building. Right? It's something that keeps me running, that I'm by nature a big picture guy, right? That's what I said before. I'm not a detailed guy, so I'm a big picture guy, so I need people for the... So. And I think that's something, with all respect, I'm not too bad at, right? Where I can see trends. I'm also not the visionary, right? I was in both cases not the one who created the core idea, right? But I think out of... I could help to develop an idea into something bigger and building the ecosystem around. And that's definitely something what I like a lot. And it's also, let's say, it's a pleasant experience to work with a great team and to run a company, right? The very moment when I think someone is better in it than I am, right, I would leave it. At the moment I think I'm doing a good job. You have to ask the lady next to you. She's working for me. But ask her later when the microphone is on. There was a question here.
Hi, I'm very happy. Hi, Christoph. I'm very happy to hear about the success model of European company joining force with Asian companies, because I come from China. I moved from Beijing 2 years ago to Berlin, and I really love it here. But one thing I see is that, of course, in China, the internet companies basically have very little idea what the European, especially internet-related companies, are doing. And everybody's looking at Silicon Valley, and it's the same thing here. I wonder whether you can provide some perspective from your international experience working with Asian companies, that in the innovation, I mean, especially internet-related technology innovation sectors, whether you see any changes in Asian countries, especially when it comes to China-related companies, and compare that culture-wise, their mechanism, you know, the drives and the trends, compare that with that in Berlin. What would you say? I mean, are they similar or there are fundamental differences?
Both, probably. I have to say that when I worked actively in China, I lived in Hong Kong for 2 years, right, traveling a lot. I was many, many times in Shenzhen when I traveled Beijing and Shanghai. Yunnan, etc. So I know China, and I love it, by the way. But I worked in the hardware business. I mean, I was in software business, but I worked with the hardware manufacturers. So that was not too much the internet companies of today. But then joining Nokia, I did a lot of in China, because at that time Nokia was very strong in China, and we started to do a lot of internet services there, right? And I experienced the community, and from that spirit, the community and building companies, right? That's not different to what people are doing all over the world, right? They have ideas, they have vision, and they are great Chinese entrepreneurs. They're also very, very successful Chinese entrepreneurs. The downside is a little bit, and that's the reason why it's sometimes a little bit difficult to connect, is of course that in China there are complete different services as we have outside of China. And that means that it's the same functionality, right? But it's a complete different service. So in that respect, I think it's difficult for entrepreneurs who are not experienced with China to look from here into China, right? Because they know Alibaba, etc. I mean, that is the phenomenon, absolutely, Mr. Ma. But it's difficult to experience the service because they are not available. Right? And I think the other point that you mentioned, that's natural. Everyone is looking into the valley, right? I mean, if Beijing entrepreneurs looking into the valley, it's like Berlin entrepreneurs looking into the valley, it's like Tel Aviv entrepreneurs looking in. The valley is the valley, right? That's like fashion men in Paris or food in Italy and in Asia as well. No, but I would love to connect China closer with Berlin, absolutely. And I have a good friend who's still working there with developers. Maybe that's something that we could initialize through the phenomenon Christoph Redke. Okay. No more questions? Oh, here's one.
You studied economy, right? Or administration? Okay. And how did you go from that to being the guy who can like see the tech trends? How do you get your knowledge for all these high tech things you worked with, like maps or
very
music streaming?
For me. Because it's how things happen, right? If someone had told me back in 1995 when I graduated that I would become a tech entrepreneur, if you want to say, or I have to do something, I would say no. I was never a geek, right? I had my first mobile phone 3 years after my friends, right? I wrote the first email in 1998, right? When others already, I mean, that's definitely something where I don't know how this happened. And when I had to go the first time to save it, I said, how boring is that? I mean, what should I do at the save it, right? And then it happened, and that's the key also to answer some of your questions here. Somehow I got this virus building companies and doing this business development, and I realized that in technology is simply so much possible and it's so dynamic, right? But I'm extremely excited at the moment that there is a digitalization of an analog world, in a sense that now hardware, all the maker movement, right, 3D printing and connecting this nest and so on, bringing together a traditional world and a tech world, right? So somehow I'm in between. But I have to say it happened, right? My wife would laugh now out loud, saying, you in tech. It's not that I have two left hands, as we say in German, right? I think I'm good with things, but it was not clear that I ended up in that. Okay.
Shall we leave it at that?
I think so.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.